Magandang umaga po, members of the Malacañang Press Corps. Welcome to the press briefing of Presidential Spokesperson Ernesto Abella. Good morning, Sir Ernie.
Good morning. Good morning to the Press Corps. We're fortunate to have here with us this morning two resource persons to talk about issues concerning their respective agencies. First is Tomas Orbos, who started his career at the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority in 2014 when he was appointed as Assistant General Manager for Planning. As Assistant General Manager for Planning, he was in charge of the preparation of medium and long-term development plans, coordination and monitoring of programs and projects, formulation, adoption, and implementation of policies and standards to rationalize and optimize urban land use, as well as provide direction to urban growth and expansion in Metro Manila. With the change in administration, Mr. Orbos assumed the position of General Manager in August this year and subsequently is designated as Officer in Charge OIC of MMDA on the 5th of October, 2016. The other resource person that we have is the Bureau of Customs Acting Spokesperson for Enforcement and Intelligence Operations, retired Colonel Neil Anthony Estrella. Colonel Estrella is a retired Marine officer who worked extensively in intelligence, public affairs, and psychological operations department of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. He was formerly spokesperson of the AFP Western Command, covering the West Philippine Sea issues. He also joined Commissioner Faeldon after his recent retirement from military service. Ladies and gentlemen of the Malacañang Press Corps, let us all give first a welcome to Chair Orbos of the MMDA.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning to everyone. Thank you for inviting us over. I guess the main issue surrounding the MMDA or where MMDA is now currently being involved in is really traffic, traffic. And under the direction of the president, MMDA now has been made part of the group called Interagency Council on Traffic, which is under the supervision of Secretary Tugade. And given that Christmas season is just around the corner, we have started looking at ways and means on how to decongest traffic. The projection is that there is an increase of about 30% traffic congestion every time during Christmas. So we've done several. The thing is, the long-term solutions that we're talking about and the long-term solutions given by this government will take some time. That's why they're long-term, no? Probably 2 to 3 years, 4 years. The first ones we will feel sometime next year. In the meantime, we at the MMDA has been tasked by the Interagency Council on Traffic to try to look for ways and means to help decongest traffic in the short term. And if I may be given the chance to mention among some of them, which we have implemented for the past 3 months, primarily we have implemented the no window hours along major roads. This is an addition to the current number coding that we had. And this includes the major roads such as EDSA, C5, Recto, Quirino Avenue, Araneta, C6, Ross Boulevard, Taft Avenue, SLEX, Shaw Boulevard, Ortigas Avenue, Magsaysay, Aurora, Quezon Avenue, Commonwealth Avenue, A. Bonifacio, Rizal Avenue, Delpan, Marcos Highway, MacArthur Highway, Alabang Zapote Road, Samson Road, and A. Mabini Street. What has happened is that since we started this, we have already tracked that the speed, especially in EDSA, has been shortened by at least 10 minutes. So we started this about a month ago. And despite the influx or the expected traffic congestion nearing Christmas, we have maintained the 10-minute up speed travel time. So this is between Monumento and Ross Boulevard. We have also, aside from this, the way Secretary Tugade and I have discussed on trying to manage traffic is to look at all the stakeholders, the ones who use the roads. And we have started making discussions, consultations with these stakeholders in the hope of reducing traffic congestion given their objectives of why they use the road. Therefore, the things that we have accomplished so far is that we have talked to mall owners, and adjusted mall hours have been from 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. starting November 1, 2016. We have also asked them not to implement any more any weekday sale, which we know has been always the cause of traffic, especially on a Friday, on a payday. You would have malls having mall sales, and this causes traffic. For your information, there are about 15 malls, big malls in EDSA alone. So we've talked to the mall owners. We've asked them if they can have their mall sales during weekdays. We have asked them, together with the delivery vans, the logistics industries, for them as well to deliver only at night. And we have also asked them to give us their traffic plans, and we have helped them manage traffic in their own areas. So that's number one with the mall owners and the delivery truck owners. We have also made representations with the utility companies and even with the Department of Public Works and Highways to ask them to have a moratorium on road repair. This began November 1 up to the midnight of, and this will last up to January 9. It used to be that there was no such thing. Even when I was in MMDA 2 years ago, there was never a request or a requirement with the utility companies for them to suspend digging during Christmas. And we made this possible beginning November 1. We have also asked several government properties to open up their roads and their routes to private vehicles. We have always heard being mentioned that government intends to open up private villages. Secretary Togadi told me, rather than open up private villages, why don't we look for public properties that we can open up? And this started already with Camp Aguinaldo. We are looking at around six more public government properties to open up. Right now, we have Camp Aguinaldo, and this will ease the traffic coming from Katipunan, Marikina, going to EDSA. We have also negotiated for a similar military property in BGC, connecting Loton and Pasong Tama Extension. This is the naval station. There is also the Office of Transport Security in the airport area, which we will open up late next week. And there's another small but very important road connecting EDSA to Jupiter Street. This is a barangay property which they have agreed to open up to us. We're looking also at other areas. Just to name a few, there's an MMDA property in Rojas Boulevard, which might help not just traffic, but even decongest some of the sidewalk vendors that are now that have been proliferating in Baclaran. Several other more. We're looking at UP. We need to talk to the administration of UP. And I'm trying to access the old network of the National Power Corporation as well as the Philippine National Railways. They have several properties in Metro Manila, which we if we open up, will help decongest traffic. In total EDSA enforcers, we have increased to around 200. Right now, we have 600, with around with about three shifts every day. We have an overcapacity of close to 20% in EDSA, even with the no window scheme that we have. We have also made representations with the motorcycle organizations for us to implement the motorcycle lanes, and of which they have agreed and, in fact, have cooperated well. We are enforcing the motorcycle lane. We're enforcing as well all the roadworthy requirements for motorcycles, as well as road safety requirements, usage of helmets, et cetera, et cetera. So it's not just traffic congestion we're looking at, but safety as well of the riders, of the motorists. If you notice as well, one truck lane policy has been re-implemented in C5 and Ross Boulevard. We have suspended all issued truck ban conduct passes. And there is a continued apprehension of illegally parked vehicles in all mabuhay lanes, in all arterial roads. We are averaging around 100 towed vehicles every day. And continuous operations of sidewalk clearing, we're averaging around 400 vendors that we take out every week. Also, the no-contact apprehension, because as you can see, the only way for us to really apprehend, because of the lack of people on ground, our enforcers on ground, we maximize the usage of our CCTVs, and we average around 10,000 a month. So basically, this is what we're doing now. Well, of course, even the other stakeholders, we talk to them, like the funeral parlor industry. We're trying to talk to them and try to see how they can help, because a slow procession would mean additional traffic. In the same manner, we're reaching out to the drivings. The way we try to handle our work right now with me and Secretary Togade is try to talk to stakeholders while we're waiting for the long-term solutions.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chair Orbos. General Manager Orbos. I would like to call on now retired Colonel Neil Anthony Estrella. And, sir.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. To give you an update on the Bureau of Customs activities, particularly on enforcement operations, and also to give emphasis on some information about the Bureau. For the month of November, Bureau of Customs operatives have seized various counterfeit products in Pasay City, Bulacan, and Pangasinan areas, totaling to about 775 million pesos. Details are as follows. On November 8 and 9, warehouses in Pasay City were raided by customs operatives with 100 million worth of high-end counterfeit shoes, clothing items seized. No arrest was made as the warehouse owners were not in the premises when the raids were conducted. And as we speak, there is an ongoing howling of the confiscated items with the issuance of warrant of seizure and detention by the collector of Port of Manila. Meanwhile, on November 18, hundreds of boxes of counterfeit branded cigarettes worth 500 million pesos and fake BIR tax stamps worth 175 million pesos were also confiscated in separate raids in warehouses in Bulacan and Pangasinan. BOC authorities and local police arrested 7 Filipino workers in the warehouse in Marilao, Bulacan, and 24 Chinese alien workers without valid working permits in Bilasis, Pangasinan. The alien workers were turned over to the Bureau of Immigration for further investigation and disposition. These raids were part of the follow-up operation that started 2 weeks ago in Davao City and Cagayan de Oro, where BOC agents also seized 88 million worth of fake cigarettes. On rice smuggling, the Bureau of Customs intercepted an alerted shipment on October 20. Thousands sacks of rice worth 20 million pesos at the Port of Manila. Commissioner Nicanor Presd'l expressed interest to exercise his option in donating these confiscated goods to DSWD for victims of natural calamities. Commissioner Presd'l also maintains a strong stance against smuggling, which deprives the Bureau of additional revenue collection. BOC will remain tough against smuggling. As we improve our maritime capability, we will pursue them in the farthest border of the country, the commissioner said. On the BOC war on drugs, the Bureau of Customs has so far confiscated around 1.173 billion worth of various kinds of illegal drugs in different operations conducted from July to mid-November. Confiscated illegal drugs include 927 million worth of shabu, obtained 11 major operations, 17 million worth of ecstasy obtained in 4 operations, and 227.7 million worth of cocaine obtained in 8 operations. BOC also obtained its biggest catch-in operation Together with the PNP Anti-Illegal Drug Group, in July in Claveria, Cagayan, where 180 plastic bags of shabu worth 900 million were also confiscated. BOC also with PNP AIDG and Philippine Coast Guard seized last July in Subic, Zambales, a Chinese fishing vessel found to be manufacturing and transporting illegal drugs to the country. Four Chinese nationals were also considered high-value targets were arrested during that operation. Also, on the screen, you will see other illegal drugs like ecstasy and cocaine that were intercepted in our major airports, particularly in Naiya. Those that were arrested are now in custody of our authorities. On revenue collection, the Bureau of Customs continues to enjoy an increased revenue collection, with the Bureau collecting 33.365 billion for the month of October. This is 89.3% of the target of 37.3 billion assessed target, and is 39 million higher compared to the amount collected for the month of September. Meanwhile, for the first 15 days only of November, the BOC has already reached 52% of its 36.495 billion assessed target. The Bureau has so far collected 18.9 billion and is confident that the assessed collection target for November will be exceeded given these indicators. On trade facilitation, since July of 2016, Commissioner Peldon has already hosted series of talks and meetings with various stakeholders. This is all in connection with the drafting of the implementing rules and regulation of the newly enacted Customs Modernization and Tariff Act. We have conducted series of seminars and stakeholders meeting, one of which was yesterday at the PICC. BOC on Balikbayan boxes. BOC has facilitated through a public bidding on November 22, just recently, the release of around 400 Balikbayan boxes that are overstaying at the MICP since March of 2016. The winning bidder, Perica International, heeded to the request of the Bureau of Customs that the boxes be released to their rightful recipients in time for the Christmas season. The good news is Perica International just gave us its yes that they will give these 400 Balikbayan boxes for free. Also, in a memorandum release on the same day, Commissioner Nicanor Faeldoan reminded all district collectors to follow the Bureau's policy on no opening of Balikbayan boxes and to expedite release and handling of these boxes. The Commissioner highlights the importance of Balikbayan boxes, which symbolizes the hardship of overseas Filipino workers and the love of Filipinos abroad to their families here in our country. BOC on its personal morale. Commissioner Faeldoan recently announced his desire to give a mass promotion to hundreds of BOC employees and personnel by December of 2016. The rank and file employees covered by this mass promotion are those who haven't been promoted for the past 5 years and those who have no pending cases. This has been the first mass promotion, if ever, in the Bureau for the past 12 years. Commissioner Faeldoan said this will help boost the morale of the Bureau's personnel, promote professionalism, and encourage employees to avoid corrupt practices. The Bureau cautioned an investigation of the death of Deputy Commissioner Attorney Art La Chica. Commissioner Faeldoan instructed all departments to assist and exercise transparency in assisting the National Bureau of Investigation, the Philippine National Police, investigating teams on the case surrounding the death of Deputy Commissioner Arturo La Chica. BOC has initially provided the authority CCTV footages inside and within the immediate premises of the Bureau prior and during his untimely death. The Bureau has also received a subpoena from the National Bureau of Investigation requesting for copies of cases that were handled by the late Deputy Commissioner, as well as the appearance of certain individuals considered to be persons of interest to shed light on the case. The Commissioner has also directed his enforcement intelligence group to provide information that will expedite the investigation of law enforcement agencies. That ends our briefing for the Bureau of Customs. We're now ready for your questions. Thank you.
Okay, we will entertain 5 to 7 questions first for MMDA Chairman Thomas Orbos, limited to at least 1 to 2 follow-up questions. Okay, any question for Chairman Orbos? Yes, Maricel Halili of TV5.
Hi, sir. Good morning. Sir, may we have an update with regards to the proposal to have a 3-digit number coding scheme this Christmas season? May decision na po ba?
Yes, thank you. The that proposal was actually a resolution passed by Congressman Suarez, and therefore, since it's a resolution, I had to take it up with the Interagency Council on Traffic and with the Metro Manila Council of Mayors. This was yesterday. Unfortunately, the mayors deem it best not to implement it yet, given the fact that there's such a short period of time and it might even cause confusion. The alternative then was for us to enforce our anti-illegal parking campaign, as well as a strict implementation of the no window, no closed door policy amongst buses in EDSA. So, as I said, this was turned down by the mayors.
So definitely, sir, it won't be implemented this Christmas season.
Yes, the agreement was for us to study it, take a look at its traffic impact, and then probably see if this can be implemented in the long term sometime January of next year. But as it is right now, it has been turned down, and as it is, it may not be implemented even for next year.
Thank you, sir.
Any more questions? Okay, Leila Salaveria of Inquirer.
Good morning, sir. I just like to clarify, has the MMDA totally shelved the plan to open up private villages to traffic?
No, ma'am. For us, that's going to be the last step. The first step is for us to look at public properties to open up, which we're doing right now. The next or simultaneous would be to look at roads, public roads that have been closed, such as barangay roads that are, you know, there are gates, there are some are, they put gates or obstructions. We understand their usage before, given the fact that this was for peace and order objectives, but given our improved peace and order situation, having gates along these roads right now is not anymore necessary. So first, public properties such as the military camps, and then public roads. Then, if need be, we will take a look at the villages. But if I may also say, we have already done some consultations with the private villages, and in fact, they're very cooperative if in case it will be necessary.
Thank you.
Hannah Jean Sancho of Sunshine Radio.
Sir, follow-up lang po dun sa mga public roads po sa barangay na marami, kinuklose po. Kasi around Makati area, sir, especially sa Guadalupe, marami pong gated na mga gates. Tapos pag may birthday, naglalagay ng tolda sa labas. Pag may patay, naglalagay din ng tolda. Hindi lang yan sa Makati, especially sa Manila, sir. Paano po yan, sir? Kasi pwede rin kasi siyang alternate route sa mga private vehicles na gustong umiwas sa EDSA po.
Totoo po yun. Salamat sa tanong ninyo. Kahapon po, kasama ng mga mayors, kausap po namin si Secretary Sueño, nag-attend po siya ng council. At yan po ay isang hiningi namin na kung pwedeng tulungan niya kami sa mga barangay captain na kung saan po sila naman talaga ang magbibigay daan na mapabilis yung pagtanggal ng mga unang-una mga illegally parked vehicles at saka tulad nun na sinabi ninyo yung mga obstruction. Pwede naman o wag lang sa oras na kailangan natin. So ang pinag-uusapan ho namin dito, mga oras na kung saan dapat wala ang obstruction. Ang hiningi namin sa mga barangay captain, tulong, at kung kailangan, kung hindi ho sila talagang tumulong kaagad, humingi na ho kami ng tulong kay Secretary Sueño.
Possible ba yun, sir, na pwede magbigay ng ultimatum ang DALG sa mga barangay captains para ma-implement po ito ng maayos?
Ma'am, if I may, hindi ho ito yung, we're not saying this is going to happen, pero ho sa paglinis po ng mga esteros, meron ho kaming agreement with the ombudsman na kung saan po nilinis namin ang isang lugar, tapos after a few months or after a while, madumi ho ulit, ay pwede na ho naming kasuhan or bring up that matter to the ombudsman. Ayaw ho namin mangyari yon, pero ang pinag-usapan ho namin ng council kung kailangan po gagawin po namin yun.
Kasi sir, parang ningas kugon din sir, like yung tinatanggal natin yung mga illegal vendors, like nun sa Guadalupe area, after a few days, babalik sila.
Tapos totoo po yun.
Pag gabi sir, yung mga naglalakad po, yung mga commuters sir, nakikipagpatintero sila sa mga tricycle at jeep na dumadaan doon. Tapos hindi makadaan yung mga naglalakad doon sa area na dapat lakaran dahil nga may mga vendors.
I fully agree. Kaya ho, malaking bagay yung pag-uugnay ngayon sa local governments. Ang una ho dyan, yung agreement namin sa lahat ng mga mayors na tutulong na ho sila sa Interagency Council on Traffic, kasama na ho sila sa aming enforcement, at ito po yung pinatibay pa sa pagsama ho ng DILG para ho yung barangay captain mismo tumulong sa amin.
Pierre Renada of Rappler.
Sir, good afternoon. Sir, there have been observations that yung implementation of yung mga coding aren't effective because people just end up buying more cars so that they can, you know, get away with the coding scheme. And people have also argued that it's really the increasing number of cars on the roads that are the reason for the for traffic in Metro Manila. So meron po bang dun sa council po, Interagency Committee on Traffic, is there any move, for example, to introduce or to re-implement yung road usage fee for car drivers and car owners, making it more, para making them pay for using the roads, which is something which Singapore does, for example?
It's called congestion fee, ma'am. Yes, we're looking at that. In fact, there is a there have been several meetings between the Interagency Council on Traffic and the Singaporean government to precisely take a look at such steps. But with regards to what you said, that it might increase such, if I'm referring to the number coding scheme, that it might increase purchase of vehicles. The ones that we're implementing right now is just a three-month scheme, so I don't think it's going to be a problem with regards to the output of buying more cars. But having said that, yes, we do agree that we should take a look at a congestion tax, or at the very least, carpooling, and we're doing the guidelines on that as we speak.
Sir, at this rate, do we know when the congestion tax might be imposed on people, like a timeline within the term, for example, of the president?
Ma'am, if I may, there are already certain sectors that use the road that are already implementing this. I refer in particular to the trucks that are going to and from the ports. They already have their own tagging system, which is in a way a congestion. It's a queuing system which they need to pay. But they're not paying the government. They're paying a private entity to manage the routes for them. So in a way, we're doing that already, and I was also informed that other sectors are looking at that. So, but if you're looking at, let's say, the use of EDSA, yeah, that will need consultation, especially with the congressman, because I think you need to pass a law. Because we've paid already our motor, the user's tax, which is the road board is doing. To put another fee might need some legislation.
So, sir, nothing definite yet on a congestion fee to be imposed upon private vehicle users?
No, not yet, ma'am.
Okay. Last question from Johnson Manabat of DZMM.
Sir, good afternoon. Follow-up lang dun po sa naunang question kanina. Sabi po ninyo, since meron na palang agreement ng MMDA with the ombudsman, meron ho bang nakasuhan na LGUs?
Meron na ho kaming finorward. Doon po sa ano po ah, doon po sa Estero cleanup.
Yes.
Meron na po.
Ano po bang liability sa limbawa kung hindi ho sila sumusunod doon sa agreement po ninyo, doon sa paglilinis na obstructions?
Well ho, ombudsman na ho yan. So they will have to face yung charges na ng ombudsman. Ang ano ho nito, yung liability nila as a public servant handling that area. So hindi ko po masabi, depende ho yan sa kaso na depende ho kasi kung ano ho yung nung gravity nung kanilang pagkakamali.
Do you have the figures po ng mga nakasuhan na sa ombudsman?
Wala po, kasi mula lang ho namin ito. I think siguro mga tatlo pa lang ata.
Okay. All right, thank you very much.
Anong city daw, sir? Meron po ba in particular, what city or LGUs?
I think siguro mahirap po sabihin kasi hindi ho city, barangay eh. And then if I refer to
the city. Is it in Manila, Quezon City, or Makati?
Hindi po. None of the three. I-ano ko na lang ho sa inyo mamaya. Kasi ang ano ho ko kasi dyan, we have yet to inform the mayor. That's why I cannot still mention to you the barangay, because may sensitivities din ho sa mayor yan. So I hope you don't mind.
Oh. Definitely meron.
Oo po. Definitely.
Okay, thank you very much, MMDA Chairman Thomas Orbos. Thank you, sir. Now, the floor is open for questions for BOC spokesperson Neil Estrella. Okay, Pierre Nada Rappler.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I just want to ask about the Deputy Commissioner Lechica. What have been the findings of the BOC with regards to the circumstances of his death? Are you looking, what possible motives does the BOC see in his death?
Currently, we are cooperating with the lead investigating agencies doing the investigation, particularly the Philippine National Police and the National Bureau of Investigation. As far as the BOC is concerned, the commissioner of the Bureau has directed, as I mentioned earlier, has directed both its intelligence and enforcement group to cooperate and assist these investigating teams. So far, yung nabanggit ko po kanina, yung po mga, meron po tayo natanggap na subpoena galing particularly sa NBI. At dito po hinihiling nila yung listahan ng cases that were handled by the late Deputy Commissioner.
Okay. Question from Leila Salaveria of Inquirer.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, where are we now in the crafting of the implementing rules for the new law raising the tax exemption ceiling for balikbayan boxes? Will the balikbayan boxes sent in December enjoy this higher tax exemption ceiling?
Well, there's been a lot of customs memorandum that were issued just this month. And yes, as far as the IRR is concerned, just yesterday, there's another stakeholders forum that was conducted and presided by no less than the Commissioner of the Bureau, Commissioner Nicanor Paeldon. And we're now trying to consolidate all the inputs coming from the public as well as their individual, even minor concerns that we're trying to consolidate so that when we start finalizing the IRR, nakasiguro na po tayo na talagang ito po ay magiging enhanced na at makakatulong na po at makakagaan sa ating mga kababayan who are dealing with balikbayan boxes.
But sir, do you have a target when you plan to release the IRR? Because without it, balikbayan boxes won't enjoy the 150,000 tax
exemptions.
The
committee handling the IRR is planning to finish it by the end of the year. Siguro ang pinaka-ano niyan is bigyan pa natin sila ng another 1 month kung hindi nila kaya with all the holidays and mga posibleng mga magiging abala for this coming season. We're safe to say that by early next year, we'll about to finalize the IRR.
Last answer. So, yung mga balikbayan boxes sent next month will still be taxed kasi wala pa yung ceiling. I mean, as of now, 10,000 lang, sir, yung exempted. So
yes. Pending the IRR, kung ano yung existing natin, yun muna ang gagamitin po natin basihan.
Thank you.
Okay. Tina Mendez from PhilStar. Microphone, please.
Sir, going back to... Good afternoon, sir. Going back to the killing of Commissioner Lechica, I read from the newspapers that a certain businessman is giving a 1 million reward for the arrest of the killers.
We don't have that information as of now.
Kasi anyway, sir, I don't know. I want to ask how it should have affected your investigation. Kasi, and besides, the same businessman is giving a 1 million reward also for the arrest of the killers who killed regarding the BIR executive. I'm wondering, meron ba siyang interest regarding the deaths of this, or the solution of these deaths?
Okay. As I've mentioned, we don't have any specific knowledge and information about that 1 million reward. But as we all know, ito pong pagbibigay ng mga pabuya para sa mga information leading to the arrest or in pinpointing the suspect is very helpful in any investigation operation or law enforcement operation. But sa ngayon, since we don't have any information, we cannot comment on that. But later on, kung talaga magkakaroon po ng mga ganyang reward, we will welcome that. Just to anything that will help fast track the investigation as far as the killing of Deputy Commissioner La Chica is concerned, we will welcome that.
Last two questions. Rosalie Cause of UNTV and then Benji Liwanag of DZBB.
Good afternoon, sir. Tanong lang po namin kung kino-consider po ba ng BOC ang mag-recommend sa presidente na i-re-establish ang COCAS o yung Cabinet Oversight Committee Against Smuggling?
We have to that question I have to refer to the commissioner and as well as his excom, and we'll give you comment on that probably on our next appearance here. Thank you.
Okay. Benji Liwanag of DZBB.
Good afternoon. Sir, number one, yung nakakatanggap ba ng threat si Commissioner Feldon because of what happened na rin dun sa Deputy Commissioner?
None so far as at the moment.
Wala with, po sang with the reforms that the Bureau of Customs is doing?
Wala po siyang nababanggit na threat na natatanggap siya. But of course, maraming, because of the technology of text messaging, alam naman po natin yan na marami pong mga umiikot na impormasyon. But our enforcement agent department is working on that.
Okay. Number two. Right now, at the Bureau of Customs, especially maraming house show before, o hanggang ngayon, meron pa rin pa ba or something?
Kung makakapasyal po kayo sa ating Bureau of Customs, isa po yan sa unang pinatupad ng ating bagong commissioner na malinis po ang ating premises ng Bureau sa mga tao po na hindi po authorized na mag-deal sa loob ng Bureau of Customs. At strictly po ini-implement natin dito na yung mga organic personnel must wear their proper identification. And even for those who are visitors are properly tagged. At doon po sa mga nagbabiolate ay talagang, katulad ng binanggit ko sa inyo kanina, ang ating enforcement department ay naging mahigpit na po dyan.
There's a parang kilala na kasi yung Bureau of Customs, especially on Fridays. Natag kayo are Friday 3 o'clock or 5 o'clock a habit. Can you update us on this?
Well, yan po yung ating ano, isa sa ating kampanya na dapat nga yung mga ganyang issues ay dapat pag-usapan natin. No? Thank you for that question. Isa po sa kampanya na ginagawa po ng Bureau ay maging transparent po sa lahat. So we welcome those kind of questions at pinipilit po ng Bureau na mabura sa kaisipan ng ating mamayan yung sinasabi nilang Friday habit na kung tawagin nila. Alam niyo po, yung sinasabing corruption issues sa Bureau of Customs ay lahat po inabutan natin at sinasabi nga na public knowledge. Ang una pong hakbang na ginagawa natin dyan ay tanggapin po natin that there is a real issue at this is a real major concern ng ating Bureau. Ang sinasabi po ng ating commissioner ay dapat po lahat tayong stakeholders ay kasama dito kung gusto natin itong labanan at talagang alisin. Hindi lang po yung stakeholders sa loob ng Bureau, yung mga nagdi-deal sa Bureau, kasama po dito ang ating public. So again, thank you for raising that question dahil isa po yan sa kampanya namin. Pag-usapan natin yung mga negative issues sa Bureau of Customs para po maipaliwanag natin sa taong bayan, how do we convert this into positive and how we really eradicate corruption in the Bureau.
Thank you. So what's the answer?
The answer is the Friday habit is tinatanggal natin at siguro naramdaman nyo ngayon, katulad nga nung sinabi ko sa iyo kanina, yung mga house na mga non-organic personnel na dati nagkakalat dyan pag Biyernes, hindi yun ho makikita yan tuwing Biyernes ngayon. Wala na ho kayo makikita ganun. With all the CCTV cameras that were in place all around the Bureau's premises.
Hindi ba sila lumipat ng Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday?
Well, that's always a possibility. But as I've said, we're doing everything to eradicate that malpractice.
From the scale of 1 to 10, where is the Bureau of Customs right now for reforms?
As far as reforms is concerned, immediately for the past 3 months, we're up to 5. We're now working on 6 and 7.
What's the hardest? Ano yung pinakamabigat na hamon na tinatanggap ngayon ng Bureau of Customs. Aside dun, syempre, alam natin, number one is corruption. Pero ano pa yung ano, matigas pa ba ulo ng mga empleyado to that effect or something?
As far as the employees are concerned, ang tingin po namin ay ang employees talaga ng Bureau of Customs ang kasama po, no, na dapat talagang doon sa ating reform agenda ay dapat po ang employees ng Bureau of Customs ang kasama nating buhabalangkas nito. Hindi po to kaya ng isang tao, hindi kaya to ng isang team lang na papasok doon at mag-implement ang reform. The commissioner now is working on motivating the employees, particularly those who have stayed in the Bureau of Customs for the past 20 years and more, to help him in the reform agenda and policies na ini-implement niya po sa kasalukuyan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, BOC spokesperson Neil Anthony, Estrella.
Thank you, sir.
We'll just open ourselves to two or three questions at most.
Okay. First question. Yes. Tina Mendez of PhilStar.
Good afternoon, sir. Welcome back na miss.
Thank you.
Anyway. Sir, yung Black Friday protests ngayon, the president ordered all military units or personnel to stay or to be restricted sa mga camps nila. Is this some kind of a loyalty check for them not to join any public protests?
I think it's exactly the opposite. I think he trusts the public to be able to handle themselves properly, and he's allowing for democratic protest. Thank you.
My question is, does he trust the military? Because he wanted them all inside the camps.
I think that's reading too much. Okay, he's simply saying that the military should not be outside, not to stand in the way as obstacles to the public protesters.
Because we know, sir, that the military component is necessary for any destabilization effort to succeed.
I think you're reading too much.
And the president has been saying all along that there are destabilization efforts against his administration.
Well, as far as his statement has been said, it states it's very clear that it's simply so that there will be no obstacles to the public demonstrations. Thank you.
Raymond Tenaza of Bomboradio.
Sir, good yes. afternoon. Sir, what's your assessment dun sa testifying of Ronnie Dayan yesterday? The president previously mentioned that Ronnie Dayan is a very vital witness, but with what happened yesterday, that he is not so much corroborating with the previous statements of Kerwin Espinosa because of some discrepancies with his testimonies. Do you still consider him as a vital witness to the alleged NBP illegal drug trade?
I think one of the senators said that there to allow for certain discrepancies, but I believe he's still a vital witness to the whole illegal drug trade situation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Next question.
One last. In which case, thank you very much.
Sir, yes. Can I ask kaya sa BOC, tanong ko sana. Sir, kasi naging problem previously is yung mga umaarbor ng mga executive officials, congressmen, senators. At this juncture, wala na ba yung tumatawag na, oy, kay Kong yan, kay senator yan, kay sekretaryan?
Again, thank you for that question. Alam niyo po, isa yan sa malaking naging pagbabago po dyan. Yung pong mga employees ng BOC ang nagsabi, halos wala na ho talaga na nag-a-attempt na tumawag sa ating ahensya, maging sa ating mga leadership tungkol po dyan sa issues nang yan. So we're happy and glad to announce that to the public. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you very much to our guests today, MMDA Chairman Thomas Orbos and BOC spokesperson Neil Anthony Estrella. Also to our presidential spokesperson Ernesto Abella. Thank you very much, friends from the media. Back to the main studio of PTV4 and Radyo ng Bayan.